Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.
Hello, friends. I thank you for coming to the third Unitholders meeting of Parag Parikh Long-Term Value Fund. I really thank you to make time of your busy schedule on a Saturday afternoon to us. Today is also the first time we are web streaming the event live. So thank you to all our friends who are sitting back home and seeing it on their devices. This is the first time we're doing it on an experimental basis. So please, those people who are at home, please bear with us if there are some teething problems. Our team is working really hard behind the scenes to try to see that it's a seamless experience for everyone. So thank you all of y'all here and in the virtual world. About the Unitholders meeting, why do we have it? Why are we having the Unitholders meeting? One is obviously clear that there are obviously questions that the Unitholders and the distributors have that sometimes don't get answered. So we thought that once a year, let's have a meeting where we can meet all our Unitholders and they can ask us any questions and we will put up a self for scrutiny and hope to absolve ourselves pretty well after that. So that's one of the things. Also, the other thing is that meet our Unitholders, get some feedback, listen to your thoughts, see maybe how we can improve. So that's the other thing. And the third thing is actually making the expectations meet. It's about letting you all know, even the first time investors who are here for the first time or who are watching us for the first time, it's about letting you all know what the fund is about, what our strategy is, what our philosophies are, what our value is. And for us, it's about also meeting the expectation that y'all will understand this and continue to be with us for a very long term. So I think meeting the expectation meet of both the parties is going to be is a very important thing. So without further ado, let me just get started. So by the way, Rajiv is also here and Ronak is also here. They both are going to be helping me today. So the format is that I will just about the fund, about I said about the performance, about what we are all about, and the co-fund managers and the fund managers of the scheme will then proceed to answer your questions if it's stock specific, and I'll answer some questions if it's business specific. So people who've been with us for a very long time, you'll be seeing this slide over and over again. This is the universal principle that we believe in. It's the law of the farm. It says that you cannot sow something today and reap the benefits tomorrow. Just like a seed has to go through various seasons before it becomes a full-blown tree, so does your investments. This principle was true 100 years back. It's going to be true 100 years from now. And this is the principle that guides us, because even our investments works exactly like this. This is a universal principle. Our investments also need time to grow. They need nurturing. They need a proactive following up about what is happening in the companies. So the law of the farm is something that we are governed by. And if you all keep coming to the Unitholders meeting, this will keep being the slide that's always going to be number one. So we believe in the long-term value investing approach to building wealth. So we believe in the long-term value investing approach to investing. So we use value investing principles. In my next slide, I will highlight how some of the qualities we look for companies or businesses. And in the next slide, I think very important is the second part is our purpose. Our purpose is to preservation of capital and a reasonable rate of return. Now, we want a reasonable rate of return. I mean, anything that is not reasonable, or if it's over the average, it's kind of called cancer in the body too, right? So a reasonable return is sustainable. It can be consistent and it can grow your wealth very well over the long term by the compounding effect. Preservation of capital is also very important. For the simple reason is, if a stock is 100 rupees, if it goes down to 50 rupees, you've lost 50% of your wealth. But the same stock coming from 50 rupees to 100 rupees, it needs to go up by 100%. So that's why it's very important that we don't lose money. So Preservation of capital is utmost very important to us, and that is exactly why we high PE stocks or fancy sectors. And this is my father always used to say this one thing. It's a very famous thing. If people were there before, they would know this is the same thing he would say, that when you chase a fancy, you pay a fancy price. And when the fancy ends, all you're left with is a fancy loss. Beyond that, nothing happens. So we are very mindful that we don't chase these fancies or these overvalued sectors, and we keep our asset allocation in check, our discipline of investing in check. Our cause is to challenge the status quo. What does this mean? So there's something called, so there's a big difference between what is a profession and what is a business. A profession is something when you do something which is in the greater interest of your client or your end consumer. When business interest takes over, that is secondary. Your clients come secondary, and all you're going to be worried about is about the business interest of it. For us, it's a profession because this activity of fund management is only about trust. You trust us to hand over your hard-earned money to us, and our trust is that you will stay here for the long term with us. So I can promise you, I think all three of us and the whole organization can promise you this, that whatever we do will be in the interest of the end customers. The good thing is that we are also the end customers, because we also have invested in this scheme. So rest assured, everything that we do will be for the best interest of the clients. So I said, what is the fund investment process, right? We use value investing principles. Number one is we're buying a business and not a stock that will fluctuate or go up and down tomorrow or will go up tomorrow or something like that. We're buying a business for the long term. We want to partner with very credible management, management who is extremely trustworthy, who takes the minority shareholders' interest all the time. So we won't be invested in companies whose management is buying an IPL company or buying a jet for his wife or something like that. So those are the kind of companies and management we will stay away from. When we're buying a business, we are going to be partnering with that company. And we're there for the long term. We also understand that businesses go through ups and downs. So we need to also give them some time to weather some of the tough times and do well for us. So we're there for the long term when we buy the businesses. We like businesses with a strong moat around. A moat is just a competitive advantage that a company has. It could be a monopoly. It could be in terms of distribution networks or patents or knowledge workers. Anything that gives the company an edge over its competitors, something that those are kind of companies we look for. Again, another important thing is we like businesses which require the least amount of capital, which are not capital intensive. If you are capital intensive, in all likelihood, the company is leveraged. They're working for the banks and not for the minority shareholders, because they're all about paying off their loans, and there's no dividends coming to us. So we like cash rich businesses or businesses which use the least amount of capital. Business having a pricing power. This is important. We always keep saying, or people must have heard, that equities is the best hedge for inflation. The reason being is that we started buying MT Educare, and then suddenly the price shot up, and we couldn't buy more because it had gone above our buying price. So we're not going to be chasing stocks if they don't come into our price range. So we actually got some of these questions actually on Twitter about MT Educare, that why haven't we bought more of it. The reason being is this, is that we started buying it, the price shot up, and currently it's neither in a buy zone nor in a sell zone, so we are holding it. Though it's a small position, it's in the portfolio. Again, as you all know, we have only one scheme, which is the Parag Parikh Long-Term Value Fund. We buy and hold equity from a value investing approach. Again, we can take advantage of all opportunities in the market, whether it be across geographies, across market caps, or across sectors. I think a really important differentiating part of our mutual fund is that we invest abroad. Currently, about 28-29% is invested abroad. Reason why we go abroad and invest is basically there are companies that are listed there which there's nothing similar to that we can buy in India. So, for example, there's no equivalent of a Google or an Apple or an Amazon in India which is listed. So we need to go abroad to look for that. Even when we say when we go abroad, it's we're just keeping ourselves to basically the Western Europe market and the US. The thing being is that we want to be in countries which publish the balance sheet in English, number one, and number two, which long history of good corporate governance. So we will not be going to China or Indonesia or Brazil or any of those countries. Right now, we're sticking to only these two countries. And most of the companies that we like or are listed are in these two countries anyways, in these two regions anyways. And also with the foreign investment, what it does for the portfolio is reduces the volatility of the portfolio. So you would see our NAV doesn't really fluctuate too much. It is very stable. The only thing that fluctuates a lot, and Rajiv ki is like saying that our NAV is very, very stable, but our rankings are very volatile when it comes to rankings in value research or some other. So that is something that the rankings are going to be extremely volatile. I'll explain to you why it's also volatile. We can opportunistically deploy our money in cash to futures arbitrage. We do cash to futures arbitrage for hedging purposes and not for speculative purposes. So as an Indian equity mutual fund, you need to be 65% invested in Indian equities. 62% invested in Indian equities. So to make up that shortfall arbitrage where we can show it as an equity position. So if for all purposes, it's just a hedging mechanism and just an efficient way to hold cash. The currency risk. So we're not taking any currency risk when we go abroad. We hedge the currency and we make about 5 or 6% currency yield on that. Add 2% dividend yield that the international stocks are giving us, about 7-8% yield we're making without the stock moving a cent. So that really acts like a good cushion for us. Typically, we like holding 20 to 25 businesses at the max, 28, 30. I don't think you'll see more than in our portfolio. I think this is the perfect for us. It's perfect diversification, about 20 to 25 stocks. Anything less than that, I think the risk of the portfolio increases. Anything much more than that, in the sense if you have 40, 50, 60 stocks in the portfolio, then high conviction ideas, even if they double, triple, are not going to do too much for your overall portfolio. So we think this is kind of the right balance that we have of diversification. Low churn and long-term holding, as you can see also from the portfolio, our portfolio turnover is very less and portfolio too much. Again, scheme structure, minimum 65% Indian equities. We can go all the way up to 100% Indian equities. 35% conventional equities or debt. And again, we use arbitrage also. And we can do as much as... So sometimes it's a, say, for example, it's a 2007-8 scenario where everything is overvalued, everything is a very bubble-like state and really understand what's going on. So at that point, we can actually do 50% cash to futures arbitrage, 15%, 35% debt, and our exposure to direct equities can be as less as 15%. So you see, it's a very dynamic kind of a fund, you know. It's today, right now, the balance fund is very much in vogue. So this is actually a true balance fund. It's not like we're going to keep changing the composition of the fund too much, but in extreme pessimism or optimism, we have a mechanism to go as low as 15% in Indian equities. So my friends on the left have all the flexibility within this one scheme. I don't think we'll be launching any other equity schemes anytime soon. One thing, question again we get is about an ELSS scheme. That is in our plans, but that is still a little while away. But if anything, it will be an ELSS scheme. Again, skin in the game, the insiders of the company, as in me, my family, Rajiv, Ronak, the research team, our directors, our sponsor companies, our trustees, the key employees, to the prunes and my drivers, have all invested in this scheme. Currently, it's almost 13% of the fund is, which comes to about 80 crores as of date. So you can, we go one step ahead and we also disclose all this information on our website. So you can see who has sold, who has bought more. So this is an important tool for the unit holders to see really aggressively selling means there's something to be concerned about. And if you're buying more, then there's nothing obviously to be concerned about. So every month you can go and check these figures and see if what changes have been made. Again, all our key employees are also in this. Performance of the scheme. Since inception, we've generated about 20% CAGR compared to the Nifty 500 of about 14% and Nifty Sensex of 10%. We're fairly happy with the performance. I think, as you can see from the graph, it's not that volatile. The NAV has been pretty stable. The good thing is that if you see from these charts also, that when the Indian markets go down or if there's a steep fall in the Indian markets, our fund actually stays pretty constant, and that's the beauty of this. Also, on my left hand side, that's the 1 year returns. It's about 15%, close to 15% for the scheme, 11.30 for the Nifty 500, and Nifty Sensex is about 8.5%. Last 3 or 4 months, obviously, Indian markets have done really well compared to the global market. It's coming down a little bit. But on an overall basis, I think we're fairly happy with the performance. And we like the fact that it's consistent and there's not much volatility in the NAV. And I think that will continue. Some updates I'll just give you. We have till May 2017 to reach 50 crores net worth. Currently, we are at about 45, 46 crores. And as we talk, our rights issue of our company is currently on its way. It's actually going on of October. And we are planning to raise 5 crores in the rights issue. So by November, December, we'll be comfortably above 50 crores. And by March 31st, I think we'll have a much better cushion. So I think that's one of the big tick marks that we needed to do. And I think that has been ticked now. From 16 September, we had changed the scheme name from PPFAS Long-Term Value Fund to Parag Parekh. The reasons is that, number one, obviously to pay homage to our founder, because of whom we all are here. I mean, he was instrumental in everything the company stood for or where the company is today. So I think that is a big thing. I think also that acronym PPFAS, sometimes we used to have people come to our office and think it's a PPF, because that's what it starts with. So we had some of those kind of things. And again, now as the fund grows bigger and as we spread to more cities, I think the accents change. So an acronym is very hard to remember and to pronounce, but a name, and Parag Parekh is a well-known name in the industry, and we thought that it would serve us best if we use that name and change the name to Parag Parekh Long-Term Value Fund. So that's it for me, and I think we can straight go with the question answers, and we'll be happy to take. I'll have Rajiv come here and just say a couple of words, please. Thanks.
Thanks, Neil. Let me add my own welcome to people who are here and to people watching us online. Before we get into question and answers, just some very basic ground rules for the Q&A. Firstly, there are a lot of fund houses who do not talk stock specific. We'll not go to that extreme, but we have to realize that there are limitations under which we operate in terms of talking about the future. So nothing that we talk about today is in the nature of stock recommendations. It's not a buy, sell, hold recommendation. Also, when we talk about our scheme, the standard disclaimers apply of mutual funds being subject to market risk, and that you should read the offer documents before investing. Since there are quite a few people in the room today and some people who will be asking questions, I request you to restrict yourself to one question, and time permitting, we'll come back for follow-ons or further questions. And one special thing to note is that we have a in-house expert in difficult questions, and that is Ronak. So whenever you have a difficult question to ask, please address it to Ronak. So let's get going. I'll request one of my colleagues to be with the microphone. Vivek is there with the microphone. So whoever has a question, please wait for the mic to come to you and then start.
What are the prospects of Noida toll bridge?
Sure.
Is it a safe investment?
Sure. Neil in his presentation mentioned that we typically stay away from capital intensive businesses, and that is generally the case with infrastructure companies. Generally, we try and avoid infrastructure companies. It's continuous capex, there's a lot of debt and so on. We made an exception to that rule while buying Noida toll bridge. Reason being that it was a mature project. Meaning all the capex was done. They had no further capital investment in their project. Most of the debt had been repaid, and the future earnings would be coming to the shareholders in terms of cash flows. The future profits would come to the shareholders in terms of cash flows. Since we have bought the company, like other infrastructure companies, it has had some amount of disappointment. And disappointment has not been in terms of what management has been doing. The disappointment has been in terms of the government not meeting its contractual obligation in terms of permitting periodic toll hikes. The toll hikes have been coming with a lag. So instead of an annual increase in toll based on inflation numbers, it's been coming roughly this kind of thing. But rest of the things has been moving on stream. They have repaid the debt on a net basis. They are debt free today. They have debt and they have cash. If you knock that out, it's debt free. Stock price is about 22. It pays out a dividend of 3 rupees, which is sustainable. It can grow as traffic grows, as toll increases come in, and so on. People who have been tracking the company would have seen that there is a case filed by resident associations in Noida trying to make the bridge toll free. They have filed a case in the court. Now, that is not something which is permissible under the agreement and whatever, but that is something which is weighing down the stock in terms of the stock price not going up. So there are these risks of political populism or the legal risk. But other than that, it's doing fine. It's not, toll hikes are not coming at the frequency we would like. But other than that, given the cash flows, given the current valuations, we are holding on to the stock. Thanks. There's one question here.
Good afternoon. My question is general in nature. What are the qualitative filters you apply while deciding or selecting a stock for the long term, maybe from the management point or maybe from the above certain threshold or market cap, longevity of growth, or how you select Because I understand your portfolio, you try planning to have 10, 15 years off. So how you identify such stock?
As such, we are a market cap agnostic fund, so we can go from caps to large cap. What practically happens is if it's a very small company, we would not be able to buy a meaningful quantity of the stock, or the impact cost would be too high. On a practical basis, typically 700 to 800 crores is a minimum market cap we would look at while investing. Management quality is something we stress on a lot, and by quality, Neil also highlighted some of this in his presentation, is that words are cheap. Basically, what matters is how their behavior has been in the past. So the words that you see in annual reports would be very similar across companies. It's how people have acted. So if people have a track record of actions which are not in favor of minority shareholders, we would try and avoid such companies. So that qualitative also goes with quantitative. So if someone says that they are very transparent, very capable, very minority shareholder friendly and all of that, but if reflect in the numbers, then obviously it does not pass the test. Again, qualitatively, in terms of apart from management, quality would come into the nature of the business. Neil mentioned things like moat. They have a does their product or service have good prospects? Do they have a monopoly or a oligopoly kind of market structure? Do they have research and development, various factors? There's a question here, Vivek.
First of all, I think a huge congratulations to the team for outperforming all the indices that you shared in the folder and in the presentation. Curious to know why and how, what were the reasons for selection of persistent systems? And actually a comment, I don't think Maharashtra Scooters, you know, meets the bar on corporate governance, though it's certainly done well in the fund.
Maharashtra Scooter one, Ronak will take the persistent.
So if you're aware of the IT sector as a whole, persistent system doesn't do what other companies are doing, more or less. So they are into a very niche area of IT sector, which is the product development, outsourced product development. Whereas everybody else are into managed services, which we know as IT services, like application and maintenance and all those things. From persistence point of view, apart from the financial metrics or whatever the business performance is, the management's clear focus has been to move away from top product development to the newer areas. And he has been saying that for the past 3-4 years, the management team also has been augmenting itself for the past 3-4 years towards this new reality that even their business is at threat and they have to move towards the new digital services space. Secondly, the downside risk of the legacy business going away is much lesser for a persistent system as compared to the bigger IT companies who are again in the same pool. And like we see, the amount of effort required to do the service is not the same anymore because of automation, or even software development tools have become more automated now. Add to that, the revenue potential for these companies from existing businesses might also go down. Whereas for a company like Persistent, where the average sales itself is a very small number per client, it is much easier. And again, from corporate governance point of view, they have been very good. The management quality, if you, you know, just do a random check in Pune about the promoter family and just anybody in the industry who has touched with them at some point in time, you will come to know the kind of nature of this person. And the history also, the company is, you know, like a grassroots company, started with just one or two clients, now grown into 200, 300 clients on a regular basis. And that too, ignoring the bigger tailwind of IT services. I mean, to have that kind of gumption to say that I will only do this Of course, he has remained small because of that. But again, he has stuck to what he can do best, and he wants to keep growing in that area. And we like that a lot. Valuation made sense for us.
Sure. I'll take your question on Maharashtra scooters. I'll also combine one question which came online yesterday about Maharashtra scooters. The online question was, why don't we sell Maharashtra scooters and put one third in Bajaj Auto, Bajaj Finserv, and Bajaj Finance. Coming to corporate governance in Maharashtra scooters, corporate governance essentially in the world, there are completely black companies and there are shades of grey. We rarely come across something which is completely white. So in each company, you'll have some grievance or the other. Broadly, the Bajaj Group has been good in terms of governance. Both the sons of Mr. Rahul Bajaj have been running their Bibli, Bajaj Auto, as well as Bajaj Finserv and Finance. And they have been big wealth creators in the marketplace. Maharashtra Scooters is a proxy to hold those companies. And it's done well for us, not because of any value unlocking in Maharashtra Scooters, but because the underlying value has gone up over time. And we have been happy participating in that journey of the two-wheeler company and of the financial services arm. Would we be happy if Maharashtra Scooter unlocked value for shareholders since it doesn't have any purpose left? Sure, we would. And we have made it clear that any resolution which favors minority shareholders, we would vote for it. And anything which is against minority shareholders, we would vote against it. But other than that, we are small shareholders. We don't have the muscle of the promoter group. So, and we are not into activist investing per se. So we are participating in that journey. A question is, should we, if we like the Bajaj Group and the two companies, should we buy the holding company, which is Maharashtra Scooters or Bajaj Holding, or should we buy the underlying companies, which is Auto and Finserv? What happens is that shareholder returns in the holding companies is determined by two factors. First factor is how well the underlying company does. In our case, in Finserv. The other factor is how much discount is there to the underlying. So over the years, that discount has fluctuated, but on an average, it has narrowed. It's moved towards more narrowing. So we have been, and some of the unit holders who are past clients in the portfolio management services would have seen this stock for 13 years now. Our first purchase in the stock was in 2003. And the discount used to be as high as 75%. That discount has narrowed over the years, and today it's below 50%. We have bought this company not because of any promise of unlocking happening. We bought it because we liked the underlying. And instead of buying the underlying, we had a cheaper option in terms of buying the holding company. Globally, if you look at holding companies, the discount at which they trade to the underlying is small. It's not anywhere close to what we see in India. In India, the worry broadly has been that the promoter group will do bad capital allocation, will siphon away money or merge loss-making companies into the holding company and so on and so forth. I don't think that risk is big in Maharashtra Scooters, given that it belongs to the Bajaj Group and Maharashtra government anyway is a shareholder. So while they are not unlocking value, neither are they destroying value in some other form. So it's more or less a status quo kind of thing. Now, when you are going to hold the shares for a very long time, if you are buying it at 50% to intrinsic, you get double the cash flows as compared to shareholders in the underlying company on a value basis. So that cash flow either resides in the underlying companies or some of it resides in the holding company, and which again keeps compounding. So our experience broadly has been that the holding company has given better return over the years. And with the new companies that are coming in, where for related party transactions, the promoter group cannot vote and only the minority shareholders have to approve those related party transactions. The confidence in the holding companies has gone up and people are now realizing that those huge discounts are not really justifiable. That's what we've seen over the past 4-5 years. Again, the trend may reverse. As of now, it's been on a narrowing path.
Hello. Yeah, next question is, my question is about the global situation, the problems of, say, Deutsche Bank, bond bubble, etc. How do you foresee things evolving and ultimately affecting Indian market? No? Problems in China and all those things.
Sure. So at most times, there'll be some problem or the other in the world. And sometimes problems are more, sometimes they are less. And all of the factors that you mentioned are factors which can cause a movement in asset prices. So a lot of people fear about what will happen to Deutsche Bank and if it were to get into trouble, will there be a domino kind of effect like we saw in 2008 and so on. The thing is that you never know, number one, whether the event will happen or not. And second is, even if the event happens, what will be the impact on the markets? So some time back, if you had inside information that Brexit is going to happen, despite what popular opinion polls are saying, Britishers are going to vote to exit the European Union, your gut instinct would tell you to sell everything and wait for prices to crash and to re-enter. But the impact lasted for a day or two, and within a week, we had crossed the previous market levels. So one never knows what will be the impact. Today, we are worrying about Deutsche Bank. Sometime back, we were worrying about Greece. Today, we don't hear about Greece. Not that the problem has gone away. It could again come back. So unfortunately, short answer to your question, I don't know what will happen. And we don't factor it in our investing process. Our effort is to identify good companies, buy them at reasonably attractive valuations, and then ride the cycle up and down.
Sir, what about IL and FS Investment Management? It has been an underperformance right since our holding.
Sure. So if we were to, if we had opportunity to time travel, we would go back and undo our purchase decision, surely. Quarter which just went by, they saw a steep drop in the profit. We still love the business model that they have in terms of getting a fee from the investments that they manage. And again, it's a scalable thing. With the same balance sheet, they can manage a lot of assets. But in terms of execution, they have messed it up, partly because of the market conditions and partly because of their own doing. So bulk of the assets that they manage are in real estate investment trust kind of things or something of that sort. Real estate market has not delivered good returns to their investors. Because of this, they have been seeing redemptions as the fund comes closer to maturity and new investors are not putting in money with them. So if you look at the fact sheet that is there in front of you and you look at the holdings sometime back, we have been reducing our weightage to the stock and we are observing what is happening and we'll decide as things play out in the future. It's obviously not worked as well as we would have hoped for. And obviously, we don't have great confidence in what's happening.
Hi, my question is not about stocks, but we have one scheme in our as a company. which is good because that's what first attracted me to Parag Parekh 2 years ago. But now what I see, I've got SIPs in 2-3 other fund houses and they have got other schemes and liquid, for example. So way it helps me is like if I get some lump sum amount, I park amount there and do a STP. Or if there's some event happening like this surgical attack, I could transfer some more. So we don't have any plans to have that.
So regarding the liquid fund, it's somewhere in our heads that it's a kind of a requirement for a lot of investors, a lot of distributor partners. As of right now, we are a little far away from that. What we tell our investors is that invest in a liquid scheme of a third party and time it in a way that you can fund in that way. You know, so it hits your bank account and straight away comes to the mutual fund. But as of right now, we are a little far away from having a liquid scheme. The reason being is, first of all, we still have to become 50 crores. So until we are 50 crores net worth, we can't even launch another scheme. So that's the first thing. So that will happen over the next 3 or 4 months. Then we would want to be a little higher than at about 55, 60 crores net worth to at least then start a new scheme. What happens with the liquid scheme is it's not a revenue generator. It's actually a cost on the company. So we need to be a little aware of our financial position before we.
Also, that's the broader vision regarding liquid fund. In a way, I've been the person that Neil and the sales team and all have to keep dragging towards eventually launching a liquid scheme. If and when we launch a liquid scheme, the returns from our liquid scheme will be lower than the liquid schemes in the marketplace. The reason for that is that if we have a liquid scheme of maybe 50 crores, 60 crore assets, we can't really go out and buy maybe commercial paper or CDs and things like that. Most of the money will have to go into the overnight money market in terms of CBLO. And the returns over there are far lower than what other liquid funds would give. So currently, most of the complaint is, why don't you have a liquid scheme? When we actually get around to launching it, the question might be, why is your liquid scheme returning so less as compared to the... But the problem is not as big. Neil mentioned this. Put it through your savings bank account and problem is not too much. If you are using any of the online platforms, again, doing that is not that difficult. Lot of exchange platforms are also coming up. So technology is finding a way to the problem going forward. And I agree it's not as convenient as having an in-house scheme, but for now, our expertise is in equities and even the scale is not conducive to launch a debt scheme.
Hi. What's the rationale for holding public sector undertaking companies?
Sorry, I didn't hear you.
The rationale for holding public sector undertaking companies?
Okay. We have public sector undertaking companies in terms of Indraprastha Gas and Gujarat Gas. We don't have much in, let's say, banks or other space. Government is not our favorite partner. They work with different objectives. Typically, we want a partner whose sole objective is running a business or its shareholders. The government acts in mysterious ways many a times. The companies that we have in the public sector space are companies which are monopolies in their area of operation, and at least in that space, profitability has not been an issue. So while we don't like government as a partner too much, but we can't ignore the other business characteristics that are there in those two businesses. We are otherwise happy with those companies. That's the reason for owning Gujarat Gas and Indraprastha Gas.
Okay.
they are monopolies in their area of operation. Again, given the environmental concerns, big shift from diesel to natural gas to CNG for vehicles. Households are increasingly using PNG. Industries, orders clamped down on DG sets and coal-fired plants and shift towards gas. So broadly, we like the businesses.
Just an extension to that, actually, the base rate of monopolistic utility businesses globally earning superior returns has been near to zero. So the fact that these companies make such high returns and any regulation can be a permanent destruction of capital.
So we are watching that space. Currently, regulator has a thing of getting people to set up networks across the country rather than trying to reduce the attractiveness. So we are watching that space as and when there is a need to move out of the companies. If we see that environment is becoming too cumbersome, we would move out.
How do you look at situations where a good business goes through any reputational damage in the short term? So it could be Volkswagen or Wells Fargo, or in Indian context, it could be a Wellspun or Nestle.
On the same subject, for those who are interested, I had written an article for Mint that link is online, and I'll be in this month itself again. We'll be putting that talk online. To come to a judgment whether it's a speed bump in a road where the company slows down, again accelerates again, or is it end of the road? Is it curtains? Typically in food companies like, let's say, Cadbury, with its worms controversy in the past, Nestle with its lead thing in noodles, or Coke and Pepsi with the pesticide residue, or McDonald's with that beef tallow thing in fries in the US and so on. Typically, brands which consumers love, there is some issue because of which sales drop, and then the company has to undertake corrective measures, maybe appoint a new brand ambassador, go out and communicate that things are all fine now and you can come back. And typically, consumers forgive and start all over again. But at the same time, in some cases, extent of misbehavior is very high and a lot of fraudulent things happen. And if that is combined with leverage, the company may not have staying power for 2 or 3 years, in which case it would be very risky to buy such companies. So figure out which category it falls into and then decide. I'll be talking about this in detail in a forthcoming talk. Maybe you can check that out later. Vivek.
Sir, my question is regarding foreign equity. We have a UPS, United Parcel Services, about 4.23%. And Amazon is very aggressive. As we see, Amazon is trying to eat up many of the businesses. And what I read around is they are starting their own courier service. If they start their own courier service, then the FedEx and UPS, they will be out of business. Any sort of insight about this and the plan that we should get out or reduce our equity on UPS?
Pranak?
Thank you for the question. We also think about it a lot, and that is the only reason we track Amazon as a company, to see which other areas it is destroying or disrupting. So I agree that Amazon is entering into the package delivery business. But that is a good sign for companies like UPS and FedEx. That means there is enough pent-up capacity or pent-up demand in the market to deliver more packages. the issue sometimes happens is between the prices at which they are delivering packages. So Amazon may want to reduce some costs, but they cannot afford to let go of one of the biggest distribution network in the US, which has been built over the past 100 years. And the efficiencies that UPS has in running their operations, Amazon will take a long time to reach there. The primary business of Amazon is to be a retailer, not as a package delivery company. So they can augment in certain areas where UPS has not put up enough investments to start their own packaging. So recently they bought a few planes, so they can obviously add on to their capacity. Some business will definitely go. And if you are aware of the UPS business model, a lot of business UPS does is now through the United States Postal Service, which is the government operated postal service. So there are different time limits in which you want a product to be delivered. So if you are impatient and you want a product tomorrow, you will want to pay the highest amount of shipping cost to get that product delivered to you, which what Amazon Prime customers can take advantage of, or even you can pay for it. If you want a delayed delivery, you can actually tell Amazon to deliver the product on so and so date after a week or maybe more than that. So it will take whatever appropriate route it has to take to deliver the package to you. Sometimes even the postal service guy will deliver the package to you, not a UPS or a FedEx or even some local small player. So the aggregator industry also works with the same network as UPS and FedEx are working on. It's a benefit for the entire industry where these inefficiencies exist in terms of packages not being delivered at an optimum cost. They're getting augmented. From UPS's point of view, right now, 3/4 of their business comes from the US market, and which is growing. Out of that, 55% is driven by e-commerce. And if you compare cost of what Amazon spends on shipping and what UPS's overall revenue from shipping businesses, you can come up to around 10% of business, or slightly less than that, will be from Amazon. If you, there's no mention of this, but you can actually back calculate and figure out. So Amazon, if it's only 10% of UPS's business and 90% comes from other areas of their operation, I'm not too worried if Amazon decides to suddenly drop UPS or even slow down their sales, because other e-commerce players are always going to take up their capacity. So we like UPS as a business because the cash flows have been very strong. Their focus and the investments have been there on the ground to grow their network. And not just in US, but also in Europe and other Southeast Asian countries or even South America. So they are growing on their own. And Amazon definitely is a threat, and we'll keep a watch on that. But it's not an immediate threat where you have to panic and sell.
Question that was not asked by you, but there are a lot of changes happening in the world, and they could impact many businesses. So whether solar energy will disrupt traditional utilities in terms of electricity, whether electric cars will disrupt internal combustion engine related businesses. So lot of changes are happening. What will happen if someone like Uber comes into delivery, pick up a package and on the way just drop off a parcel? So all these are futuristic questions, and one has to be keeping track of things as to what change is coming. As of now, I don't think it's that much of a threat to UPS. But if you ask the same question, maybe 3 years, 5 years from now, maybe the answer could be different.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, reasons for our investment in 3M with the continued persistent slowdown in European markets?
So, so there will be different markets growing and slowing down at different points in time. The have in the US via direct stock or via ADRs, these are global multinationals. So while Europe may be slowing down, the emerging market piece for them will be growing at very fast rates. So essentially, we are looking at the overall growth of the company, overall prospects, rather than worrying too much about an individual segment or an individual geographical market per se.
Hi. Would you mind explaining the rationale behind Would you mind explaining the rationale behind the highest investment being in Alphabet Inc?
Sure. This question, and there was another question which came online which was what are the that I would associate with our investment in Alphabet. What could go wrong with that investment? So Alphabet, for those of you who are not keeping track of this, is it's the company which owns Google. The activities that Google does as of date, and leaving aside some of the very futuristic things, basically it's the number one search engine, owns YouTube, it owns Maps, it owns Gmail and various other properties. Android, of course, the number one mobile phone operating system. Now, given that it's so entrenched in our daily lives, it while we are using Google, we are also with each use giving it information about us. Now, this information is very valuable for advertisers. So, in the US, the ad revenue of Google has exceeded that of the entire print industry. And our own event is being live cast on YouTube Live. And recently, you would be aware that there was this US presidential debate between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, and the number of people who watched the debate on YouTube exceeded the television audience of all TV channels in US combined. Of course, global audience, but still, that's a very significant shift. So given that a lot of media consumption is coming to the digital medium, a lot of advertising is also coming to the digital medium. And it's a company which really dominates that space. It's growing at a very decent clip, even at a on a large base. And again, it meets all the characteristics that Neil pointed out. Not very capital intensive, moat in terms of almost monopolistic characteristics, technological barriers, high growth rates and everything. It has things that one would like in an investment, and that really is the reason for a large weightage. It always was a large weightage stock, but some of the weightage that you see today is on account of price appreciation rather than buying so much quantity at the original price. What are the risks that are there associated with the company? One big risk I would see is antitrust legislation, in either in the European continent or in US, where one company dominates a space too much, regulators try and slow them down, either in terms of their ability to undertake large acquisitions or just prying open the door to other competitors and so on. So that is one risk that is there. The other risk is has been there for all along Google's journey, but you can't ignore it, which is opinion of the consumers on privacy issues. So while we are happy to get relevant information from Google, but sometimes that nagging worry is there at the back of the mind. Why should they know so much about us? So that is another risk that is possibly there. The third risk, which seems remote as of now, but again, one cannot completely eliminate it, is that the risk of lagging behind in technology, meaning someone coming and introducing something which is way, way ahead of what Google does in terms of helping us in our lives, and we stop using Google and shift to something else. Seems remote as of now, but as a possibility in somewhere in the future. Thanks.
Yeah. Good evening. Could you give us a sense of the asset quality of banks? Because HDFC seems to be least impacted, but someone like Axis, which had a scare in previous quarter results.
Sure. again, there was another online question on similar lines about Axis and ICICI. How do we see those? The entire banking space, with some rare exceptions, like let's say maybe HDFC Bank or someone like Kotak or one or two others, broadly everyone is having an issue of elevated bad loans. And this is actually a nature of banking. Typically, a lot of lending, lot of capacity gets built up when things are good, and when business goes through a downturn, a lot of those loans turn bad, and those loan losses have to be taken through the profit and loss account over a few years, and the balance sheet has to be again clean and cycle starts. What happens is, if the extent of the problem is too much, then you have situations of banks getting into trouble and being forcibly merged with others, or being forced to raise a lot of capital at very low stock prices and things like that. I think that risk is big in PSU space. I'm not that worried on that front. ICICI and Axis go. In terms of being consumer franchises and having that customer loyalty, having a large customer base, all that is there with all three of them. Again, just as a random data point, all of these are having good current account, saving account balances, what we call CASA, at a 4% saving bank interest rate. A lot of others are trying to get CASA. Some of them offer rates as high as 6% and 7%, but still some of them lag these banks in terms of the proportion of CASA. So there are problems in these two banks, Axis and ICICI, of bad loans, but I don't think they are life threatening. I think it's again something like a speed bump. They have to clear their books over 1 or 2 years, and it's amply factored into the valuations. So of course, our largest bank position is HDFC Bank, but HDFC Bank is at whatever, 4.5 times book versus, let's say, around 1.5 time for ICICI, or more than 2 for Axis. So a lot of it is already factored into the valuation, and one has to wait for a couple of years before they really clear out the troubled loans. Also, in the case of ICICI, you have their investment in subsidiaries, which are good businesses in their own right. So their mutual fund investment, or their life insurance, general insurance, investment banking, stock brokerage, all of these are good businesses that they have.
Sir, considering the fact that Tesla is on the path of disruptive innovation and threatening oil and auto industry, and boasts the almost monopoly in the space where they operate, electric cars, why don't we include a part of it? I'm not asking you to include, as in not asking that to include major chunk of that, but just for the,
which company you are?
Tesla.
Tesla,
yeah.
Okay. Ten years from now, 20 years from now, will we be driving more electric cars as compared to internal combustion engine? I think answer is yes. I don't think that we will continue to have these petrol burning cars or diesel burning cars. As and when electric cars come in, who will be the winners? I don't know the answer to that. There are many players trying to come in this space. Tesla is not the only one. You have a couple of companies from China. BYD is there. You have Foxconn trying to do something in this space. You have traditional automakers. So Chevrolet is launching its own electric car this year itself, the mass market car. Teslas will come somewhere later, and even the Chevrolet car has got good reviews from the auto magazines and all of that. So I've read everything that is there to be read about Elon Musk and Tesla, and I keep following developments over there, but are we confident of buying the company? Answer is no. again, whether it's Tesla or Amazon, disrupting companies, amazing founders and promoters, but if you don't have profit showing on your P&L, how do you value it? So we don't want to buy something just because it's popular or it's in the fancy. I don't think we'll buy either of these two anytime soon.
Hello. Hello.
This is on your on the foreign holdings.
Yeah.
It mentions something about them being hedged. Are these on a monthly basis, yearly basis, half yearly basis? How do you take care of that?
Hedging happens on account of by use of cash flow future, by use of currency futures contracts on NSE. These contracts are available for periods up to 12 months in terms of liquidity and all. Usually the most liquid ones are 1-2 month kind of things. But depending on prices and availability, we would use the month which is convenient and roll it over as it comes closer to expiry. As long as we have the underlying position, we keep rolling over the hedge.
Hello.
Yes.
In the cumulative returns chart, if one sees that your return over the benchmark Nifty 500, the return difference is around, I mean, the outperformance is around 3-4% over the benchmark. Over the benchmark Nifty 500. So would you attribute this solely to the Indian stocks, or I mean, is it possible to give some color on whether this has been more because of the overseas assets or domestic?
It really fluctuates very significantly. Just to give you our journey in the fund, we launched in May of 2013. May of 2013 to somewhere about Jan of 2014, overseas stocks were doing really, really well as compared to the Indian stocks, and they were contributing to outperformance. Then you had our Indian general elections, and it seemed clear that one single party majority will come, and you had the so-called Modi wave, which really propelled Indian equities. So for a long time, the overseas investments were a drag on our portfolio. Then Indian market went into some sort of a big correction somewhere. And again, for quite some time, overseas stocks were contributing to the outperformance. So really, it keeps fluctuating. Broadly, over long periods of time, both markets do well. It's not that one does well and the other does not. So 5-year basis, US markets have done better. 10-15 year basis, Indian markets have done better. 20 years, US markets have done better. So it keeps fluctuating. What happens is when you combine the two, the portfolio volatility goes down. So I wouldn't attribute return difference to any particular market. What I would attribute the low volatility is on account of combining the two markets.
मैंने सुना है कि स्मॉल कैप्स बहुत अच्छा रिटर्न्स बनाते हैं लंबे समय में, सबसे ज्यादा रिटर्न्स, हालांकि रिस्की भी होते हैं, स्मॉल कैप्स ही बनाते हैं. तो अपने पास स्मॉल कैप्स मुझे इतनी समझ नहीं है, हार्डली हैं, क्या आप इसे एक्सप्लेन करेंगे?
अलग अलग मार्केट फेज होते हैं, जबकि अलग अलग सेगमेंट परफॉर्म करते हैं और आउट परफॉर्म करते हैं. जो बुल मार्केट, जो तेजी बोलते हैं, उस समय में स्मॉल और मिड कैप में ज्यादा रिटर्न्स मिलते हैं, और जो मंदी आती है, जब बेयर मार्केट होती है, तब स्मॉल और मिड कैप का फॉल भी उतना ही ज्यादा होता है जनरली. हमारा फंड जो है वो मल्टी कैप फंड है, यानी स्मॉल कैप भी ले सकते हैं, मिड कैप भी ले सकते हैं, लार्ज कैप भी ले सकते हैं. एक सेगमेंट जहां नहीं लेते हैं वो है माइक्रो कैप, बहुत ही छोटी कंपनीज नहीं लेते हैं. अप्रोच ये है कि जो कंपनी में निवेश कर रहे हैं वो कंपनी अच्छी होनी चाहिए, उसके प्रमोटर अच्छे होने चाहिए, उसका जो कारोबार है वो अच्छा होना चाहिए. ये अगर अच्छा है तो हम निवेश करते हैं. अभी कई ऐसी स्मॉल कैप कंपनीज हैं जो बरसों के बाद भी अभी भी स्मॉल कैप है, वो बड़ी नहीं हुई, जबकि कोई कोई कंपनीज होती हैं जो छोटे स्तर पर शुरुआत करती हैं और बड़ी हो जाती हैं। हमारा अप्रोच ऐसे कोई एक सेगमेंट पर फोकस करने का नहीं है, हम अक्रॉस मार्केट कैप निवेश करते हैं।
सर, इसमें यूएस फॉरेन इक्विटी जो है वो सब अमेरिकी कंपनियां ही दिखती हैं, एक आध नेस्ले जैसे है स्विट्जरलैंड की कंपनी, तो दूसरे जगह भी हम निवेश कर सकते हैं या सारा फोकस अमेरिका पर ही रहेगा?
नेस्ले ग्लोबल मल्टीनेशनल है, एनयूजर बुश जो है वो भी यूरोपियन कंपनी है, ग्लोबल मल्टीनेशनल है, स्टैंडर्ड चार्टर्ड छोटा पोजिशन है वो भी ग्लोबल है, लेकिन जो कंपनीज यूएस में लिस्टेड है उनका भी कारोबार सिर्फ यूएस में है ऐसे नहीं है, इनका काफी सारा रेवेन्यू और प्रॉफिट्स दुनिया भर से आता है। ज्यादातर डीलिंग यूएस एक्सचेंजेस में होता है, तो जो बाहर की कंपनी लेते हैं वो भी एडीआर के थ्रू लेते हैं, अमेरिकन डिपॉजिटरी रिसीट के थ्रू। बाकी देशों में निवेश करने में कोई प्रतिबंध नहीं है, लेकिन फिलहाल ऐसा ही पोर्टफोलियो आप एक्सपेक्ट कर सकते हैं।
सर, लास्ट क्वेश्चन, जब ये मार्केट
सर काफी सारे लोग पूछना चाहते हैं, अगर समय रहा तो फिर आपके पास आ जाएंगे फिर।
हेलो, जस्ट वन क्वेश्चन, सो व्हेन यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट महाराष्ट्र स्कूटर्स, वुड यू बी लुकिंग एट अदर होल्डिंग कंपनीज एज सच लाइक ग्रासिम और आईडीएफसी लिमिटेड और अ कॉन्ग्लोमरेट लाइक पिरामल एंटरप्राइज?
Sure. So the starting point is not that we want to buy holding companies. The starting point is which are the companies, which are the businesses that we like. Now, if we identify those companies, those businesses, and if there happens to be a good holding company trading at a very big discount, we would opt for the holding company instead of the underlying. But we don't start off saying, oh, let's start and look for holding companies. If something comes up, maybe yes. But that's typically not the way we would start off with. Thanks.
Good evening. Yeah. What is the investment rationale behind Ceylon exploration?
Ceylon is a primary oil producer, meaning they dig a hole in the ground and take out crude oil and sell it off.
Very minuscule.
It's a minuscule position. It's not very big. That's right. Typically, there is some element of capital intensity, but once you set up the well, there's nothing much to keep pumping in. It's not like telecom where you have to go from 2G to edge.
I am from oil exploration. This business is much more riskier than the telecom.
Yeah, I'll answer that. Yeah. I was addressing in terms of the capital intensity. I'll come to Ceylon in specific. So Ceylon, from whatever interactions that we have had and whatever reports that we've read, the approach of the company had been to look for fields where there was promise of oil being there, but which were abandoned because the market price at that point in time was not conducive for commercial exploration and production. So they have these fields in Rajasthan where a lot of preliminary work has been done and where apparently there is oil in the ground and where more work needs to be done to bring that to the market. So essentially when we bought it, it was on the premise of volume of production going up. What has happened since is that oil price, which at peak had gone to as much as $140, has collapsed to around 30-35 and then rebounded now about 50 or thereabouts. So given that kind of wild ride in the oil prices, obviously the
the prospects for this company don't look that good, and it has come down given that oil prices crashed, and really the fall was quite steep, and again I don't have an answer as to where the oil prices will go from this point in time.
Even this company does not have the scalability also.
Scalability meaning it has rights for those fields, and
but those fields are very minuscule.
Yeah, so market cap is also minuscule, right? So you'll have a market cap of a SEBI, and you'll have a market cap of a ONGC, you'll have a market cap of a Exxon Mobil, all will be different levels. Given the kind of the fields that it has, its market cap is okay. So the problem is basically it's in a commodity business, and the commodity that they sell has come off in price in a big way.
As an investor, I have serious concern about it.
Okay, we'll note that. Thanks for the feedback.
Thank you.
These are the people who run this company only. So they are not, it's not like a Munjal or a Mahindra. It's not a business group in that sense.
Yeah. Yeah. Couple of minutes earlier, you mentioned about the online media consumption. Today, our meet is broadcasted live via YouTube. Also, in India, Netflix and Amazon Prime have started making a move. So, I would just like to know your views about Indian media sector.
So, Indian media has always had huge promise, but very few companies have actually been able to deliver. And very ironically, the companies that have been delivering have been in the traditional media. So, we still have, for example, vernacular newspapers increasing their print circulation and readership. Lot of people have tried to corporatize it, to bring systems and processes into it, but ultimately it still remains a creative business and a business where you have a few hits in a sequence and suddenly the prospects will look very good, and then a few flops come in and down and out again, things go out of budget and things like that. So creation, it has its own vagaries, whether it's television channels, they compete against each other to outbid other people for new releases and so on. So again, it's something that we have tracked, but we haven't found conviction in any particular company to that extent. Some of the things where we which we liked, liquidity was an issue. We couldn't see a meaningful quantity that we could buy, so we gave them a pass.
Sir, we have got three private banks, ICICI, Axis, HDFC. Plus, the lot of companies which you are telling about like Celent or MT or Noida, they are not performing. Wouldn't it be better to switch over to the new companies like something in the microfinance sector or like the ICICI and Prudential Life Insurance, which is recently listed? I think the recent listings are quite good companies. MGA are getting them at the starting stage, so as to say, the listing stage. So switching over from all the three banks and a few of those non-performers, I think it should be a bit more active than the passive investment which we have been doing. So.
Sure. So I'll take this in two parts. If something is not doing well in terms of are not having confidence in the business prospect of the company in the future, we tend to sell off those. So in response to an earlier question, I mentioned that our exposure to something like Island FS investment managers. Noida, the stock price is not doing well, but other than that, the company is doing what we would expect it to do. So just moving from stock to stock, given that which has gone up and which has not gone up, actually ends up increasing churn and ends up increasing transaction costs, and you sell something which is cheap and you end up buying something which is in fancy. So that is not something that we would typically do. We would not buy fancies, and I would probably classify the NBFC and microfinance space as something which is priced to perfection. Everyone is saying that all these companies will keep growing at huge rates, and if anything were to go wrong, either in terms of growth rates or in terms of asset quality, you could see losses. Again, investing in recently listed companies, it is not a surefire formula for success. So a big listing of the past bull market, one of the biggest real estate companies, you would have said, oh, a new listing and such a good opportunity to get in at the entry level. It's not worked well. So I'll not comment on each company that you have mentioned in terms of possible alternative investment, but we keep scanning the marketplace for opportunities. At the same time, we keep looking at our existing companies and deciding whether something needs to be sold. We will continue to have a churn which is generally low, and a lot of people have this problem of not showing anything which has not done well in their portfolio. So what they do is, moment something has not risen, they'll quickly sell it off so that it doesn't appear in the fact sheet or the portfolio disclosure. They've lost a huge amount of money in it, or even if the prospects are looking good. We are not in that camp, and clearly when you go out to invest, when you buy in 20 companies, there'll be 15 which will do well, or maybe 10 or 12 which will do well, there'll be 3, 4, 5, 8 which will not do well, and across different times. Sometimes a company will go through a bad phase and then eventually recover. So when we are advocating looking at equities as owning a business or as partnering with the promoters in their business venture, then you have to go through the ups and downs. You cannot be doing a musical chairs kind of thing that for 3 months I'll own this and for next 3 months I'll own something else. Be the way we would look at investing.
So this is the first time I'm attending this meet. So I have a very fundamental value investing question. So when you talk about a reasonable price for investing, what do you mean by reasonable price? Is it a statistical method? Because if we look at, if we go by pure Benjamin Graham's value investing philosophies, we will never be able to invest in quality moated business which are trading at above 40-50 PE. Further, a follow-up question is, how do you calculate an intrinsic value of a business?
Okay. This will be the last question we take from the live audience. What we'll do is some tea and snacks served outside for people who have taken the time out. You can avail of that serving for people who still want to listen to the discussion. You can hang on for a few minutes. What we'll be doing is now is we'll be taking questions from our online audience, from people who have been posting it on Twitter. As far as your question goes, Ronak is the absolute expert on how to what is a reasonable price and how to do intrinsic value calculation, so he'll take it.
Full price, even if it's a valuation, even if you think it's a definable term, it's not really, because each business will have its own dynamics, its own asset valuations, its own earning capacity. And based on that, we have to compare the valuation. So although we can use several metrics like price to sales, price to book, price to earnings, or price to free cash, or whatever metrics we choose to use, they are just tools to measure that company through various scales. That does not mean that these numbers, that the answers that we get, are of any statistical relevance at a particular point in time. So the first thing that we focus on is understanding that business very well, trying to figure out, is the promoter and the management of the company sound, and are their interests aligned with the minority shareholders? After that,
That's the first check. The second check is how well the business is going to perform in that industry. What is the opportunity size for that business to grow in that industry? Are they competitively placed? And for that, it requires, so far we can use numbers as a guide or a milestone to figure out how they have performed with the same characteristics and same dynamics. But that does not guarantee the future performance also. Figure out the earning capacity of that business or the earning power of that business. Then we can compare with other companies in the industry, and we can compare these valuation metrics and see where this company stands vis-a-vis that. And again, it's not a statistically relevant sample also sometimes to figure out. So for example, if you're tracking FMCG companies, the most statistically relevant thing to do is compare valuations of all FMCG companies across the past few decades in India, in global markets, compare cash flows and everything. But again, that will not give an answer that is this the right time to enter in this stock or not. So apart from looking at, reasonable valuation is a judgment call. You might think that a 25 times earnings is much more expensive. I might think 25 times earnings for this type of business or a typical type of business may be a reasonable value to pay. So again, it's a subjective call. We do tend to adhere to several principles that you mentioned, you know, Benjamin Graham's way of looking at businesses, but the kind of markets he was operating at that time do not necessarily exist today. It was available at below cash or, you know, at close to book may not be a relevant metric today to continue. So I'd like to remind you of a very interesting law. It's called Goodhart's law. At the moment a metric becomes a target, it ceases to be relevant. So the moment you try to adhere a particular valuation metric, say price to earnings, and you keep a target in your mind that say 15 times is my target of entering into a company. If it is above 15 times, if it is 15.1 times earnings, I will not touch it. Point of understanding what this business is going to do in the future. And I think focusing on the business is more relevant than fighting over an Excel sheet answer that you have got. That's my view of valuation.
I'll take a stab at it. So whether you are talking equity shares, whether you are talking bonds, whether you are talking real estate or aircraft leases or whatever, financial theory says that there's only one correct way of valuing these. Discount all the future cash flows to the present value. So this is very simple for bonds and things like that in terms of lease rentals and so on. But for equities, and this is my favorite quote relating to valuations, for equities, trying to use DCF is like trying to use the Hubble telescope. An inch, you are in a different galaxy. So when you use inputs into the DCF, meaning terminal growth rates, discounting rate or various other parameters, you will have such a big range of values that it will not be meaningful. Point you to a interaction between Munger and Buffett in one such session. Buffett says DCF is the correct value. So Munger says, I've never seen you do it do a DCF. Buffett says that there are some things that you do only in private. And the jokes apart, what he said is that to do a valuation, if you have to employ a spreadsheet and put in 20 variables, then you don't have enough margin of safety. Then you are relying too much on precision. Face off it, you can say that I'm paying, let's say, 100 crores for the business, and I expect, let's say currently it's paying me 20 crores a year in terms of cash flows, and I expect it to sustain. Obviously, it's attractive. It's giving you 20% on your investment price. If you are buying it for 100 crores and currently it's paying you only 5 crores, that is a 20 PE, then you need confidence that whatever is your hurdle rate, the future growth rate will increase cash flows to that level, meaning it will be able to give you your desired returns. And if you are buying something for 100 crores, which is loss making, let's say Tesla or Amazon, then you have to really be a very big visionary look far out in the future and figure out how much the company will be able to. The more the cash flow that you're getting in the near term, the lesser your risk. So, no safety. There's no one precise formula. Maybe Tesla and Amazon's are the next multi-baggers and they'll really create wealth, but maybe not. So, ultimately, it's not so much about formula. It's not so much about mathematics. It's about business acumen. How well are you able to see this business 3 years, 5 years, 10 years out? I think that's the main part. Okay, for people who you can, and I would urge you to please avail of the refreshments. We will take a few questions from the online audience and then we'll revert to people who are here in the room. Anak, maybe you can give a mic to Nandan.
Okay, we'll take a few questions from Twitter and some from YouTube as well. So this question again is on Alphabet. The questioner is asking, how do you calculate intrinsic value of such a dynamic company like Google?
The method of valuation is the same. Essentially, you have to value it on cash flows, the money that is coming in. You have a company which is at whatever, $500 odd billion in market cap. You have a company with a lot of cash on books. You have a company with tremendous amount of free cash flow and a company which is growing well. So I don't see any difference in the approach to value this company as compared to valuing, say, a FMCG company, for example. The only extra care that one has to take here is that one has to be careful of not paying up too much, number one, because people many a times get too excited about technology companies. So people get excited about things like Uber or Tesla and whatnot. And second is, one has to be careful that the business is not about to be disrupted. So that is something that one has to be cautious of, that the moat that we are seeing is sustainable and not something that is ephemeral and which will go away. I'll just urge people to just close the door over there. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. We take the next question. So this is on Balkrishna Industries. Why do we prefer this company over the other tier stocks such as SEAT, MRF, which trade at a lower valuation?
Pranath, you'll take that.
The tire companies that we know of in India are in a segment where they make tires for regular road on-road vehicles. BKT or Balkrishna Industries, they make off-highway vehicles which are used in agriculture, construction and mining, etc. So the business models are reasonably different. So the primary process of making a tire is the same, that you take rubber and make a tire out of it. But the business model is different in such a way that they have to maintain at least 3,000 to 4,000 stock keeping units or different varieties of items, whereas these companies will have a few number of SKUs which they are going to make with the same raw materials. So that gives, and also the business model is more dealer driven. So BKT has all of the business mostly is export and they sell to Europe and US and other countries outside of India. And other companies are basically selling in the Indian markets. So in terms of valuation, you may compare them, but as a business, they are totally different. And the cash flows that Balkrishna can generate probably over a cycle, because they are catering for pre-ordered tires as compared to you stock the inventory and then sell them later in the market, better sense at the valuation it was available at. Raju, you want to add something to it?
Okay, the next question is more about financial planning. So the question asks that, they are planning to invest for education of their kids. What kind of returns can I expect in, let's say, a 6-7 year time frame?
mutual fund is a market driven product. There are no assured returns, and there can be no guidance on this front.
Okay. Next question is on ICRA. What is unique about ICRA? Why not CRISIL or CARE?
So at some point in time, we were owning both CRISIL and ICRA but in the earlier days. But essentially, we exited out of CRISIL on account of valuation, and nothing against the company. The stock became too expensive. ICRA also, over a period of time, has gone up in valuation. So earnings have not kept pace with the rapid pace at which the stock prices run up. And this was especially after Moody's acquired a majority in ICRA. When the stock was at very high levels, we have sold some of the stock, some stocks. We have reduced the weightage over a period of time, given the high valuation. But at the same time, it remains a high quality company, and with the possibility of increasing business coming their way, some of it from Moody's. Also, recently there is this move for the large borrowers to move to the bond market rather than avail of bank lending. So we'll give a fillip to the rating business and to the overall environment for rating companies. Nothing against the other two. I'll restrict myself to that.
The next question is on IPCA Labs. So the question asks, what exactly is the moat for this company? And won't the contract sales or sales that they have lost, what would they be coming back? So they have lost sales due to some US FDA issues. So what is your take on that?
So the second part of the question is easy to answer. The answer is, I don't know. Even the management is not sure as to the timeline that they can give to the shareholders that when those lost shares, lost sales will come back. The first part is an interesting question. I don't think IPCA really has any significant moat. The advantage of IPCA as a business is they are one of the lowest cost producers in a few categories of medicines that they export. And with that advantage, they could get into global contracts like the Global Fund to provide in, or even in the US markets, they could compete at much better prices as compared to other competitors making the same product. This is the goal of FDA is to make sure that the prices of drugs are in a controlled range. And IPCA, if they can produce at a lower cost, their prices also were reasonably lower, maintaining their own gross margins lower than the competitor, and they could maintain a high enough market share. The unfortunate event happened is that two of their plants got FDA warnings, and which they are now remediating. And we'll see when FDA will come for a revisit and when they will give a go-ahead or a permission to start sales. And because there is a shortage of drugs, of a few type of drugs in the US, the FDA still allowed them to sell those drugs, those specific drugs only in the US market. So it's not like the FDA is completely unaware of the quality of this company. It's a momentary hiccup and we'll have to wait when the numbers will bounce back. But if you see the capacity that a company has been adding, even after the FDA announcement has come, the capacity has actually increased. So the sales will have to catch up now in the future. And their marketing activities are again, distribution activities are already going on. So we'll have to wait and watch when the numbers will come. But the business is sound.
Okay, the next question is on MT Educare. The questioner just wants to know what are your current views on MT Educare.
I don't want to give a current view based on a buy, sell, or hold recommendation, but we have been monitoring that business. They are reasonably different to other supplementary education businesses because of their online activities, their RoboMate platform they have created for kids, or the learning management solutions. Find out when a student goes and compares it with the other coaching classes available. But that business is an extremely fragmented business, and they are trying to do something new in that business to generate scale. Non-MT students, non-MT educare students to even participate and purchase this content and learn from it. It is right now in the startup phase, that other scalable business, and we would like to see that. But we are not entirely displeased with the existing coaching class business. So we think the promoters are good, the management is doing a reasonable job to the company. Although we haven't been able to procure a lot of shares in the portfolio at the current price, our buying price was much lower. So we'll see when the price comes and the business still makes sense to buy, we'll know when, and we cannot really comment on that timeline.
Okay. The next question is more on the process of investing. So the question wants to know, do we always meet the management before we buy, and are they always candid? Are the management always candid?
Okay. Meeting the management can be one of the factors which you can consider in the investing process. If the company is big, widely covered in the media, lot of press releases, quarterly analyst meetings and so on, then we may not need a one-on-one meeting. A lot of information is out there. Again, the business may be so clear that you may not need to meet the management. In some cases, you would have questions. After all your analysis, after all your due diligence, if there are unanswered questions, sure, a management meet is required. But basically, what matters is their behavior in the past actions that they are undertaking, rather than the words that they put out, either in a written, orally in one-on-one meetings. Again, a lot of people have read this book by Philip Fisher, Common Stocks and Uncommon Profits, and lay a lot of emphasis on scuttlebutt. What people don't realize is that the book was written in a different era. Number one, the corporate communication was not that great at that time. Information was hard to come by. And second is the laws were different in terms of what constituted inside information and what did not. So today, even if we meet management, we are not trying to get to know anything in advance which is not public knowledge. We are only trying to, where we possibly have a misunderstanding in terms of how the business operates or in terms of the general business environment. Are people candid in terms of communicating or not can be known only after passage of time. So what helps is, were they candid in the past? If they were, then one has to go by their word. Pranak, you want to add anything? Yeah.
Okay. The next question is about Apple. So does Apple really have a big moat? It takes majority of revenue selling devices. Will this last for next 20 years? Their services aren't as unlike Google.
A debate which we have very frequently in our office also. Apple devices, which are iPhones, iPads, MacBooks, and some other accessories, also come with the operating system. So iOS and App Store for iPhones and iPads, and Mac OS for MacBooks. A lot of people say that we are not buying Apple products because of the hardware specifications, but we are buying it for the whole experience, for the whole ecosystem. And there are differences of opinion in the company. Some people say it's a ecosystem. What one has to see that increasingly, as more and more devices go out there in the marketplace, there are that many more people who will buy apps on their iStore or who will do in-app purchases for various services. For example, if they buy a magazine subscription on their iPad through the App Store,
Apple would get a cut from it, or if they music service, again Apple gets a cut from it. So increasingly it's becoming more of an ecosystem, and as years go by there'll be a bigger services component also coming in. In the mobile telephony space, in the smartphone space, essentially there are two winners. You have iOS and you have Android. Obviously we love Google also, it's a top holding, but at the same time Apple also has its loyal fans and followers who are not going to go away. One thing that is clear is that the has slowed down. So if earlier people were replacing their phones each year, maybe they do it every 2 years or every 3 years. So that evidence is visible in the sales currently. And despite that, valuation wise, we think it's good. There's no issue with that. As with any company where there's possibility of disruption, we need to watch it. And if there is some change in view, we will act on it. But for now, we think apart from just a hardware device. Yeah, again, lot of cash is there on the books. So for a company which is as a market cap north of $600 billion, a big portion of that might come back to shareholders in terms of either dividend or share buybacks. And they've already laid out the path for holders north of $200 billion, somewhere thereabouts. So that also helps in terms of giving comfort.
Okay, you mentioned reducing stake in certain businesses. So what would cause you to sort of decide to reduce your allocation to a company or to sell?
When we buy a company, we would buy a company with good business characteristics, some moat, as Neil mentioned, and with an attractive valuation. Now, either of these could change with passage of time. It's something very dramatic, meaning management that we thought was transparent suddenly does act which is so shareholder unfriendly that it requires a complete sale, we would exit completely. But if there is either a temporary trouble in the business, or if somewhat, there would be adjustments in the weightages rather than a complete exit. So it would really depend on each case differently, and changed from our original buy thesis, we would act accordingly.
Okay, this is about our fund. So from a fund point of view, as you grow bigger in size, how much do you think you would have to modify your approach to investing, or do you think that it is still some time off?
I'll give a rough.
Also, I'll just add an extra question to that that just came in. As cash comes in every month, are you compelled to buy?
Okay. Answer to the cash question, as cash comes in, we are not compelled to buy. 700 cash coming in, going out, average about. So that gets added or reduced from the money market. Fund the money market deployment that we have. Benchmark, if we are at a 700 crore asset size, the minimum market cap of the company we invest in would be 700 crores. This is just a very rough benchmark. Individual exceptions. We become a 1500 crore fund, then ideally we would not want to buy companies with market cap of less than 100, 1300 or 1500 crores. So as we become bigger, buying into very small companies becomes difficult. Other than that, nothing. We are still able to invest in overseas stocks. We are still able to invest across sectors and across most market caps.
Okay, this is about our allocation to the foreign stocks. What are the tax implications for our foreign holdings?
The fund on its dividend income on overseas stocks pays about 25% tax in those countries. Other than that, there's no tax either on the fund or the investors of the fund. It's like any other equity mutual fund in India. Capital gains that we earn on overseas stocks are exempt from tax. The fund does not pay any tax over there. And if investors in our fund stay in a year, they don't have to pay any tax on their gains as well under the current tax regulations.
Okay, I'll just combine this question. So the question is, what is the moat for business like ICICI Bank, Axis Bank? Specifically on Axis Bank, historically they had some issues in capital allocation. So why do you think they will be able to future?
In banking, typically there's not much of a moat globally. In India, ironically, the moat arises because this is one of the few areas where there's still a license raj in that sense. Of banking professionals cannot just simply get together, raise some funds and start a bank. License from RBI, and which is Mumbai. And again, industrial houses are not permitted to start banks. So you won't have Tatas and Birlas starting a bank, for example. Foreign banks operate under severe restrictions in India, given that they don't allow our banks access to their home markets. Of the banking businesses run by public sector undertakings who run it under their own considerations. It's not many times run like a business, and efficiency is not given that importance. So with scale, have it good, given that there is overall growth in money supply deposit year over year, and overall these people gain market share. So that way you can say that there is an element of moat in well-run private sector banks. This bank, like any other bank, they go through periods of elevated loan losses and things like that, but they have been among the biggest wealth creators in the Indian market space. So anyone who's been in 10 years or so, I don't think anyone has any reason to complain. Most people have done extremely well on their investments in Axis Bank.
It is ICICI Bank.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Bank has had, people who look back long enough would remember that earlier it used to be a development finance institution. So it had all these term loans to projects and all. And when they came into the banking space via merger with their subsidiary, they had over a period of time to maintain all those CRR, SLR, and that transition itself issues also. For some time, they were crazy. They did not pay enough heed to the risk that they were carrying, and they went through a lot of trouble. But actually, that was under a different individual who was at the helm, and now you have a different person at the helm, and hopefully they have learned their lessons in terms of paying equal importance to risk and growth, and not ignore risk while chasing growth.
Okay, I think probably now two more questions. So question is arbitrage component. So the question asks, there is a small component in your fact sheet termed arbitrage. Could you explain what you do there about identifying these opportunities.
Okay. One is that the, for example, there are two stocks in arbitrage for the last factor motors. Essentially, the let's say we own 100 shares of Tata Motors, then we would be Tata Motors in the future segment. So in our demat account we'll have 100 shares, in our futures sale contract we'll have 100 shares. So on a net basis we will not have any exposure to Tata Motors. Whether the stock goes up or whether the stock comes down, the NAV should not be affected. How do we go about identifying companies and how do we execute this transaction? Our dealing desk as well as the brokers, they monitor the spreads between the spot prices and future prices. And there are computer algorithms which identify this. So let's say if the spot price is 100 and in the futures market, if the stock price is 101, that is more attractive as compared to another stock where the spot is 100 and futures is 100.50. Because here we are getting a 1 rupee spread. In the other cases, we are only getting a 50 paise spread. So we would go for stocks where the spread is more.
Okay, I'll just combine two questions here. So one is about our exposure to small and mid-cap stocks. Space in general has run up a lot. So are you worried about the valuations of these stocks within our portfolio? And then the question is on Mahindra Holidays and Resorts. The questioner says that it has low return on equity and hasn't performed well. So what is the outlook?
Sure. There has been a lot of run up in small and mid caps, and I would agree with the questioner that if at all there's risk, the risk is more in some of the mid cap space names rather than the larger companies. What does one do with this? Essentially, one will have to take a individual stock call, and wherever things are not that comfortable in terms of either valuation or business prospects, one has to exit or trim down. The Mahindra Holidays, at the time of our purchase itself, he was going through some trouble in terms of execution of addition of room inventory, satisfaction levels and things like that. The stock had fallen from its IPO level to a sub IPO level, maybe more than the IPO price. So since our purchase, the things have been on a improving path. Corrected some of their sales practices, brought down the selling cost, tackled the receivables to some extent and so on. What we like about the company is the business model, where resort inventory is essentially funded by the customer advances, and where the company itself does not have to lay out a lot of capital. We are monitoring it and we'll see how it plays out. Difficulties, but broadly it's been on the improvement path rather than deterioration.
Okay, I guess this is the last question. Probably answered, we answered it before as well, but do you hedge the fund's entire foreign currency exposure?
It's hedged to the extent of about 90% of the underlying exposure. We are through with the online questions, so if there are people who want to ask questions, we can questions.
Hello. I have been associated with PPFAS for the last 1 year now, and I've seen that the portfolio hardly changes. So this implies that PPFAS feels that out of the 100,000 stocks in your universe, these are the 15 best stocks which you can select. Is that the case? Is that the implication?
See, the entire universe of stocks, no matter how big the research team is, they will not be able to have full coverage and what people refer to as circle of competence, meaning expertise to arrive at a business judgment for the entire universe. The way things would go about is, first you start with a process of elimination. You eliminate bad management, you eliminate capital intensive, very low return on equity businesses, all of that. You're left with a smaller subset. There will be sectors which are too difficult to understand, which where rate of change is too high, or where you are not able to arrive at a significant confidence. Again, you give those a pass. Does it mean that that space cannot be a multi-bagger? It could be a multi-bagger. So we had a question on Tesla. We had a, or maybe Amazon. Am I 100% confident that our portfolio, then the stock price of a Tesla or Amazon? No, I don't know. But I will not invest in something where I do not have confidence or capability. After eliminating all these, you arrive at a set of companies tracking and where you have some confidence. Within that subset of the universe, you invest in 25 names, 30 names, 25 names. After you buy it, you have to give time to those companies either to perform or to not perform. For both, you need to give time. You cannot go on 3-month stock price or kneel at the first slide. If you plant a seed, give it ample water, fertilizer, sunlight for it to show results. And some seeds may not full-blown trees. On an average, if you are doing well, it's fine. You have to give it time. You can't be jumpy, meaning 2 quarters the company has not done well, let's sell this, let's get into something else. Business does not work that way. If something is a consistent failure, then you ultimately cut your losses and you something. Give time to things over a period of time.
Good evening, Rajiv, and not for you. You were mentioning about the holding companies. By far, arguably, the best one would be Berkshire Hathaway, with its great holdings in companies that specialize in insurance, cat, and super cat as well. What is your take on it?
Yeah. See, as a manager who will work virtually free for you, it's the best deal going around, meaning if you can hire Buffett and Munger to manage money for you for $100,000 with the plane thrown in, it's a good deal. The problem is that the Berkshire of today is not the Berkshire of 30 years back or 40 years back. One is, it has grown very significantly in size. And second is that increasingly the nature of the business is regulated utilities, where it's those natural gas pipelines or power plants and things like that. Now those will give you some kind of return. So as investors with a smaller size and with a mandate which is more flexible, our personal feeling is we can do better. So coincidentally, Berkshire also owns Apple, and we also own Apple by some coincidence. Around the same time we were buying, and happy to announce we bought it much lower than where they have bought. Apple directly, or should we buy Apple through Berkshire Hathaway? I think better to buy Apple directly rather than own all of their utilities. Insurance, of course, a wonderful business, wonderful managers also. You have people like Ajit Jain managing their large insurance things. Geico, of course, for their auto kind of insurance, a great business. But I think we can do better. Again, at a price, we would be very tempted to buy Berkshire. And also, we have a free put written by them. If it falls below book, obviously, they would start their buybacks. So then the downside is very, very limited. So if it falls somewhere to that level, maybe we would be tempted. We would buy.
So my the Indian timeshare industry. So what I think is that the timeshare industry is generally moves towards an oligopoly or a monopolistic nature, because it's based on customer money, which again attracts more customers. So in that case, it's best to be aligned with the major player, which is Mahindra Holidays in this case. So do you think there is any threat from Sterling Holidays, because we saw Thomas Cook acquiring Sterling and it's been backed by a
Sure. So what you mentioned, there is some there's a lot of merit in that, meaning there are these network effects. Just like if every one of your friends is on Facebook, you have to join Facebook. You can't join a different social network and be the only one in a lonely room over there. And again, in the context of newspaper, Buffett has said survival of the fattest, meaning a newspaper with most content, most readers will get more advertisers. And given that more advertisers are there, they'll be able to provide more content. So that network effect is there. Similarly, in timeshare industry, if company A is offering 50 resorts, then for company B to try and compete, they have to offer a significant variety. You can't start a resort, timeshare resort with and compete with the market leader. So given that, there is an advantage that someone like Mahindra Holidays would have. Prem Vatsa's investment was in, and later on Thomas Cook has acquired Sterling. Is seeing what happens, some legacy. They had sold timeshare units and they had to default on a lot of those. After acquisition by Thomas Cook, people who lost money have lost money. So there is some amount of negative brand recall for Sterling. Let's see how that plays out. Obviously, Prem Vatsa's group is very well capitalized. But again, as you mentioned, it will be at best a two-player market, Mahindra and Sterling. It tends towards oligopoly over time. We're watching the space. Yeah.
Hi. So I have just a couple of questions and I'll make it quick. One is on the investment by you and all the promoters, if I might use the word. I think for some reason you disclose only the latest number, not the historicals on the website. So unless we have saved it, we don't really know the trend. But if I remember correctly, it's from the last time, we don't see much additional investments in terms of number of units being bought. So just as an investor, how would you advise us? How should we read it? Like if you are not investing, maybe it is not the right time for us to invest as well. If we have the exact long-term time frame for you, exact same risk profile, and we are willing to live through volatility, how would you advise us on that? And second is on the FX. So I'm still not clear, but just to understand for the balance 10% portion, suppose we had bought Google, say, 5 years ago and the currency has depreciated. So we would obviously be making money on the currency part. So how much are our returns, if you can give a broad number, maybe 50 bips, 100 bips, how much our total return is actually coming because of the FX depreciation?
Okay. Your feedback on some historical thing, I'll probably talk to IT guys and maybe we can put some back numbers. As to personal investments, see, you have to take it into the context of what Neil mentioned again about raising the net worth. About 5 crores of money has to be put in to the asset management company and capitalize it to 50 crores. So obviously what money goes into the AMC is money which is not available for fund. We are not, again, when we tell investors not to try and time it, we ourselves don't try and time it. So my SIP is going, my wife's SIP is going. Vivek, could you please close this door? Just allow entry only from the back doors. Just lock this, please. So we have our SIPs going, and depending on availability of funds, we buy. And sometimes, again, we may need to sell also. So if we, let's say, if I want to shift to a bigger home, I may need to redeem my investments and buy a home. Or if we want to put money in the asset management company, we would need to have cash for that also. So people can interpret it in whatever manner they want to interpret. We put out the data what we have, meaning how much of our money is there. Pace may increase, decrease on various factors. I don't think we can put a qualitative thing to the investment. It's just a disclosure as it is. You had some other question? FX part. Broadly, the foreign exchange premium is 6% on an annualized basis. So if 30% of our investment is overseas, 90% of that would be, let's say, 27%. On 27%, 6% would be contributed to by the currency decline over time.
Yeah, there are a couple of portfolio turnover numbers. One is 2.7 and one
Yeah,
there are a couple of portfolio turnover numbers. One is 2.7 and one is 84.31, including and excluding arbitrage. We read these numbers and interpret
sure.
them.
Sure.
Yeah.
So what happens is, given that currency hedge happens by use of derivative contracts, and given the fact that cash flow futures arbitrage is typically on a monthly basis and it needs to be rolled over, or sometimes you exit the stock completely and get into some other stock for arbitrage, those result in purchase sale transactions. So if 27% of the portfolio is hedged by way of currency hedge, and that gets bought and sold every month, then in a period of 12 months there are a lot of transactions. If you look at, if you pick up the fact sheet of our first month, for example, May 2013 or whatever, May 2014, 15, and if you look at current fact sheet, you will not see much change in the stocks that we own or things like that. There would be some changes, obviously, but it would not be too much. It's just that some of these arbitrage transactions and derivative transactions number which elevates the portfolio turnover ratio. Yeah, and again, the core portfolio turnover is a number which is actually the investment positions coming in and going out. And again, currently 2% kind of thing is an unusually low number. Realistically, I would expect if on an average our holding period is, let's say, 5 years or north of that, it would be in the region of 20% or somewhere thereabouts.
Yeah, my question is about the pharmaceutical industry. Now, generally, this segment has got historically very high valuations. And last 1 year, it has come down considerably. Now, I see only two stocks in our portfolio, Pfizer and Ipca, totaling 3.05%. Do you see this as an opportunity to increase the weightage to the pharmaceutical industry?
So, pharma space, traditionally, people have been saying it's a defensive sector, where people put money there to get steady returns. But over the past few years, mostly the past 5 years, if you be precise, regulation, regulatory bodies like FDA or MHRA or the European regulatory bodies, they have tightened their regulations in terms of the quality of drugs that they want to be imported from these Indian companies. Mainly because of the Ranbaxy incident that has happened in the past, where a whistleblower came out and said that there were blatant issues in terms of quality of drugs being exported. The certainty of cash flows and revenues from pharma companies have come down dramatically because of that. So it's no longer a situation where, say, a pharma company may be operating in a steady state manner, has products in the pipeline, but if the plant is not able to produce any drugs and export it, the revenues will not show up. So from that point of view, the expectations on the pharma sector have reduced overall, that we can see to the numbers as well. But if you track the businesses of these pharma companies, you will see those who are hit by FDA announcements or regulatory issues, their numbers have, the actual business numbers have dropped dramatically as compared to the steady state companies which are out there. It is definitely an opportunity if you can understand, apart from the regulation, the product pipeline and how these companies planning to gain market share in some drugs. Because in pharma, there is a constant race for deflation. Every new generic drug maker that comes into the market, the price of that drug in the market drops by, say, double digit. And that basically makes sure that you have to keep producing at lower cost and going to newer areas. So it's a constant race. So you have seen now oral solids market, which is the pills that we take, that is now moving to injectable or more complex dosage forms. Then from there, you are seeing going to biosimilar technology of making drugs, which is natural organic drugs that are used. So all these innovations keep happening. The bigger companies with bigger scale who have higher R&D budgets, they can participate in it much better way than the smaller companies. So it's your ability to understand the product portfolio of a company, their ability to sell that, assuming FDA regulation does not happen too often. And again, it's interesting to buy them when they're hit by a FDA issue, and we know that it's temporary. So we have to focus on all these parameters and then figure out if the opportunity is good. And frankly, it's difficult to then filter companies because every company has a different issue. So I wouldn't be so positive about the sector as such, but if you can understand specific companies with specific business economics and opportunities, I think it can make an interesting time to enter.
क्या क्वेश्चन फार्मास्यूटिकल से रिलेटेड है आप बोल रहे हैं कि ये ज्यादा नहीं बढ़ा लेकिन 3.05 बहुत ही कम है हमारा इन्वेस्टमेंट थोड़ा तो भी बढ़ाना चाहिए ऐसा
द रीजन सॉरी माय हिंदी इज नॉट सो ग्रेट सो लेट मी रिप्लाई टू इन इंग्लिश द रीजन इज स्मॉल इट्स बिकॉज़ वी हैवंट डेवलप्ड इनफ कॉन्फिडेंस इन अंडरस्टैंडिंग व्हिच कंपनीज टू स्केल आवर पोजीशंस इन इन्वेस्टेड द एफडीए इशू ऑलरेडी हैपेंड And we are waiting for the remediation and whatever numbers that come in. We may not increase the position. So I don't want to give a call on when we are going to buy or sell existing pharma positions. We keep a watch on the sector and it's under active coverage. So whenever we think is a good opportunity to enter into these companies or any other company, you will see it in the fact sheet of that month. Otherwise, I really cannot comment on why 3% or why more.
Hello. Yeah. See, our direct expense ratio is 2.22 as per the fact sheet. So is it because of the AUM which we are having today? And if it's because of the AUM, then in future, what do we project like, as we go forward? Like, will it come down like AUM wise or is there any other methodology?
Yeah, so you're right. Right now, the expense ratio is that because of size. As size increases, cost will definitely come down. I've actually also given a schedule of how the cost will come down. Currently, as of yesterday, we are at about 700 crores. When we reach about 750 crores, that expense ratio will go from 2% to 1.75. At 1,000 crores, it will come down to 1.5. So that is the schedule. Obviously, it is on scale. Basically, as the scale goes up, cost will come down.
Sir, 2 points. In your presentation at the outset, you mentioned that your international investments give you a return of 8%. That means if your CAGR is 20.93 composite domestic, international, as well as arbitrage and debt, if entirely we had a domestic exposure, our returns would have been far superior. Obviously, we will be subject to greater volatility.
So, So that's what he said, right? At different time, different markets have done well.
Yeah.
So the 8% that you're referring to does not include capital appreciation of international stocks. That is just currency plus dividend yield.
Okay. And if we count the appreciation of the international.
Both are very similar.
It comes around 20% or?
Yes. Yes.
That is excellent. And the second point was, sir, in your portfolio, I saw a little disturbing investment that was in IPCA Labs. Don't know, but tracking the history of IPCA Labs, right from the time when Mr. Ajitabh Bachchan was there, along with Mr. I think Mr. Chandurkar is the only decent promoter or the only decent top management in that company. Otherwise, the kind of riffraff which has happened in the company and continues to happen very recently, you know, the objections raised by FDA on such wrong disclosures. Another Indian company is Alkem Laboratories. They give totally 100% wrong disclosure at the ultimate stage of consumption of generics. Boss, FDA is still lenient on India. If it was an American company in America doing that, they would have shut down the shop. Your choice of IPCA is beating my logic. I have been marking a pharma industry since a very long time. I was associated also with the industry. I mean, the choice of IPCA, we have companies like Lupin. You have a very good account investment in Pfizer. MNC companies, where is the problem? GSK or Pfizer or Lupin? As a matter of fact, Dr. Reddy. But why IPCA?
So let me separate your question. Yeah. For IPCA and the FDA issues.
Yes.
So the FDA website is incredibly transparent in terms of maintaining records of whichever violations have come up for all pharma companies, not just Indian pharma companies. You will find more serious or extremely severe violations done by even MNC pharma companies. The biggest generic companies in the world have also received much severe restrictions on manufacturing because of worse issues than what Indian companies are facing. So the main issues that Indian companies are facing, if you just zoom out and see the pharma issues right now, are data integrity. One is not maintaining proper records and reporting, as you said, false records to FDA. Second is not maintaining hygiene of the laboratories, which is required as per their standards. There is a broader angle for the FDA to tighten up on the regulations on Indian companies. I mean, these issues have always been there. They have also probably shut down many plants or recommended corrections in many plants in the past. But now you see it more often is on twofold. One is the number of facilities that India has compared to any other exporting country in the world is much disproportionately higher. We have more than 550 or 580 facilities in India, which is the highest across the world, exporting to America. That means that the budget allocation and the manpower allocation by FDA to scrutinizes facilities has also gone up over a period of time as the budgets of FDA has gone up, the federal budget has gone up. That is the political part of FDA which we don't have any control over and no need to focus too much on. Now coming back to IPCA, I agree the company has a very entertaining past, especially 20 years back. But in the past 10 years, what the company has been able to achieve in terms of manufacturing processes, selling to the same country and other export market in terms of cost competence in a few APIs that they were making. So you have to see the evolution of pharma companies. I wouldn't say this is the best company in the industry, but in the valuation parameter in terms of the way they were operating their company and the products that they have, we thought it made sense. Again, like I said to the lady's question before, there is no restriction on our companies in the sector and we are tracking it continuously. But since you have been in the industry, you will be aware that it's so complex to track each and every drug's progress and market share data is not easily available. So then you have to be cognizant of that fact that which company is going to get cash flows from which drug going ahead. So Dr. Reddy's, you mentioned several drugs which were dropped because of Ranbaxy's exit from the market were picked up by many of these Indian pharma companies, Dr. Reddy's or Sun Pharma and Aurobindo. Now smaller companies who are growing are basically at the heels of these bigger Indian generic companies trying to enter into their markets by pricing the drugs lower, because now they have the capability to make those drugs. It's a deflationary cycle and we have to go with the companies who have some sound direction in which they want to take the companies in. we found this management to be one of those managements. There are many more, and we, as we cover a sector, we might change our opinion or stick to this opinion. We have looked at FDC in the past. Again, not to comment on the company as such, it's a great business. They are very strong in the domestic market. We are aware of it.
Then the next lowest product in that segment and what deliverance they have. But then that goes with Mr. Chandavarkar.
Yes.
The culture is there.
Great product portfolio.
Yes.
Again, valuation is a very important concern for us. If
yes.
we don't understand how to value the company, we will
yes.
not touch it.
Yes.
We thought we understood this. So that's what the allocation is to that extent.
Very true. Very true. Thanks. Thanks.
We'll take one last question from the gentleman over there. Vivek.
This is coming to the investment in emphasis. Now with the new change in emphasis being a P-driven company who have a very short P's, have a very 3-year, 2-year, and they want to flip the asset. What's your view on the company?
So emphasis has been a very interesting company. We've been owning it for how many years now? It's 10 years now. So it's a legacy investment from the PMS days. And the story at that time was that HP being a partner giving more revenue to this company and the other business is a bonus. It turned out the exact opposite way. HP's business started going down and the bonus actually started growing up. So now HP's business became a bonus revenue for this company, which was the parent in the past. The change that has happened now is actually extremely positive for the shareholders because the trend with private equity investors or investment minded promoters is that they focus more on capital allocation. There is, I think, 30% of the market cap is in cash right now. And if you look at this business, the capital allocation policy, which they will announce eventually, they have given the announced the latest dividend also after the new promoters have come. I think we'll have to wait and watch in terms of how the top line and bottom line will change. But I think capital allocation wise, you will see a much better company going ahead in emphasis. One last online question.
Yeah, so the question is about Standard Chartered. So why are we investing in Standard Chartered compared to other foreign banks like JP Morgan or Citi?
Actually, Standard Chartered investment is a case where we thought we were too smart and market became a bit smarter than us. What we were doing is we were buying the Indian company which traded at a Indian IDRs. Standard Chartered is listed in India on the BSE NSE. Standard Chartered on BSE NSE at a 20% discount to the international stock price. We would convert the stock to the underlying shares and we would sell in the overseas market. And in terms of other valuation parameters, price to book, and other whatever NPA numbers and all, it seemed a decent investment. So essentially, we were saying in a year, we will make 20%. If the stock falls, we'll make a little less. If stock rises, we'll get even more. So that's what we were doing. The conversion, unfortunately, we can't convert it well. Only a part of our investment is allowed to be converted. What happened is bulk of our investment we could convert to the foreign stock and sell at a profit. Unfortunately, what happened was the last residual quantity before we could convert, the stock price crashed and all the asset problems came out. So we have made a lot of profit on Sandchart in terms of selling in the past, but we are stuck with the residual quantity. Now it's gone through a bad phase and now we have got the conversion done to the underlying shares. While we had IDRs, liquidity was not so much in India to be able to enter exit very smoothly. Now we own the underlying shares and we are watching it. Eventually we would probably exit it at an opportune time. Thank you so much for coming here. We are still around. We will probably interact over a plate of snacks or something. Thank you for taking the time out and coming here. And thank you also to the online audience. Look forward to seeing you next year.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.